let's start with the basics, Professor. Why did you sign that petition?
So the petition expresses the concern that these kinds of systems are extremely unpredictable. In essence, we have really no idea how they work inside. And so they simply don't comply with principles that have already been established. For example, the OECD has a set of principles that have been signed up to by the United States and all the other advanced economies, saying that AI systems need to be shown that they will not present undue risk to users. And at the moment, there's no way that we can show that these large language models don't present undue risks because we don't know how they work. And there are already many, many stories of apparently psychotic conversations, the one reported in the New York Times, for example, one reported in the Belgian press just the other day of ChatGPT working with someone as they prepared to commit suicide and in some ways encouraging them to continue with that.
Stuart, those are the broad risks that the petition identifies. There are lots of questions about the petition itself. For example, when it was first published online, Sam Altman, the CEO of OpenAI's name, was listed. OpenAI told us at Bloomberg that he never signed it. Have any of the organizers or you as signatories among yourselves discussed that some of the names on that petition may actually never have signed it?
So I think what happens when you open one of these petitions for people to sign up online and add their names, a lot of jokers come along and put somebody else's name for fun. And probably someone thought it would be cool to pretend to be Sam Altman. I think Xi Jinping, that name also appeared. And so very quickly, the organizers realized that they were being subjected to a campaign of disinformation, so to speak. And so they put in steps to slow that down.
Elon Musk is a signatory to this petition. I've written to Elon Musk multiple times in the last 48 hours to try and confirm that he actually signed it. Are you confident that it was actually him that signed it?
So I have to say I had no role in the preparation of the petition or in the vetting of the signatures, but Max Tegmark, who is the president of the Future of Life Institute, which organized the petition, is in direct contact with Elon Musk. And so I'm pretty confident that that's a real signature.
What you're asking for is a halt of 6 months, a specific period where next generations of large language models or the underlying technology that powers the generative AI tools we're talking about are not released. How realistic do you think that is to coordinate, that everyone agrees to just stop?
I think there are different ways of viewing what we're asking for. I think the idea that the CEOs of Microsoft and Google and DeepMind are going to read this and say, oh, sorry, yep, you're right, we completely messed up and we'll definitely stop right now. I don't think that's going to happen. But I hope that it at least begins a serious conversation about what would be necessary to develop systems that we can have confidence in. And there's two parts to that, right? Could we develop ways of testing the systems that we already have so that we can show that they do not present risk, that they will not help people to commit suicide and so on, or we change the way we design the system so that we can do that. And I actually think the latter is probably more likely. I would also say that legislators, the European Union, for example, are close to passing the AI Act, which would require these kinds of steps as a matter of law so that you could not put systems on the market unless you could satisfy the regulators that they were safe.
Professor, 24 hours ago, we had Sarah Gao, who's a founder of a VC firm called Conviction, on the show. She's been investing in AI for a long time. She was not a signatory to the petition. Have a listen to what she had to say about this.
I really care about access and also reinforcement of bias. But the thing to do is to address these concerns in like a open and transparent way, not to call for a halt to development.
In the context of a halt or a 6-month period of non-new releases, Sarah's point is that she thinks the technology should be made increasingly available more broadly. What is the risk with that?
Well, as she pointed out, the systems already exhibit bias and various other kinds of problems. So by making further generations of this technology available, which might be much more capable of causing serious disruption in our society, that would only make things worse, not better. I think what we're asking for is that the developers of the technology take their responsibility seriously.
Professor, we're grateful for your time. You're staying up late for us out of Singapore. You come at this from the academic perspective, the research and policy perspective. But when I went to our audience and asked about questions for you, they basically ask, is this just sour grapes? Is this those in the field that look at OpenAI and say, you're the leader here, we are trying to catch up, and that's why we want to halt?
No, not at all. I mean, we're not in the business of competing in the commercial market. Some of the underlying technologies of large language models emerged from academia, and pretty much all of the deep learning technologies emerged from academic and basic research labs. So this is really a question of asking that the systems that are deployed that affect the lives of billions of people are actually systems that we understand and that we can show are safe, whose capabilities we can predict. I don't think that's too much to ask.